Hi, everybody. Russ on the West End Network. I'm not in the toilet today, as some people said to me yesterday. Hope you're safe and well. If you're new around here, please consider subscribing. If you like what we do, please consider subscribing. It's Hammers Headlines in association with the KUMB.com boys. It's Thursday, almost another week done, but obviously it means Chelsea 12:30 kickoff on Saturday is going to be an early one for Russy B. And so we'll be having all the preview and stuff like that. We had an ex-player preview at lunchtime today with Scott Minto, who has a foot in both camps. And so we're going to include a clip of that for today, actually, because that's what we're doing for Hammers Headlines today, all around sort of Declan Rice, the academy, that type of thing. Three sort of news stories, two of our own news stories, which is nice for a change. So let's start with that. So obviously, for those of you who may know, you may not know, we were gracious enough to get an hour and a half of the Mr. Academy, the Oracle, Tony Carr's time last night for a live interview, live Q&A session. We had a few guests on asking him questions. Obviously, with so much that's been happening recently with the academy and a certain perception of it's what's the point of having it if the likes of Ashby, if the likes of Sonny Perkins, if the likes of Elise are leaving to play for other clubs. So we had Tony on and some really good questions from the chat, and it was an incredibly open and honest interview from Tony, who celebrates be celebrating 50 years since he started at the club, all the way from Alan Kirbishley and Paul Brush, all the way through to Declan Rice. He's had a hand in all those developments in terms of academy boys that have come through the ranks. So lots of good questions about it, about the academy, his view, his current view on the current crop of players coming through, what it takes to become an established Premier League star now for the youngsters. And some of the ones that got away in terms of, Elise, he name-checked as one of the guys who was surprised that he moved on. But, he obviously doesn't know the ins and outs of everything that's gone on. But as a player, when he left, he was 50, in the under-15s, but playing under-18s level. So he was playing, two or three years above him. So the first question Anton asked was, what is an academy? What is the academy to Tony, in terms of the truest sense?
What is an academy really designed for? What's the real purpose of an academy and essentially West Ham's academy of football?
Well, my, I want to say instruction, but my leadership was always about, we've got to find and produce local talent that will be good enough to play in West Ham's first team.
Right.
And if we can't achieve that, will set young lads on the path of having a career in professional football. But first and foremost, the success will be not that they go off and play for someone else, but they play in West Ham's first team. Yeah. That's the first, if you like, objective. Yeah. If along the way we sell them after a few games, like we've done over the years, that's part and parcel of where the club are financially, or in the league, or relegation forces things. But really, you want young players that come and play in the first team. That, in a sense, is what the penultimate achievement will be if they play in West Ham's first team. Yeah. That's what, or get them a career in the game. But that's secondary.
Yeah, that's secondary. So the main criteria was develop the young local lads to give them that real opportunity to be West Ham heroes for the rest of their careers if they possibly can, with a back at secondary option for a career in football. So I suppose another question then is, from the first moment you got into the youth setup, say at West Ham, to the moment before you left,
yeah,
did you see a transition in any of that criteria that you said,
the philosophy really of the club? I mean, I was just going to come back in again and say, well, it's different now, it's changed, and I think the change was the development of the Premier League. And although it's an absolute success, it's one of the best leagues in the world now, if not the best, the most competitive anyway. All the best players are here. And that's the problem, because there's so much money. The best teams and most Premier League teams can go and buy their players globally, and they've got the money to do it. So that pushes the bar even higher for young talent. So a local boy from Barking or East Ham or anywhere in London or the surrounding areas, Essex, etc., he hasn't got to be the best player in England anymore. He's got to maybe be the best player in Europe in his position, or the best player in the world in some respects in his position, depending on the team and depending on the stars that you purchase. So it is tough now to get into academies in the Premier League, certainly. In some respects, you would say that, and a lot of managers would say, well, if he's good enough, he'll play. Well, yeah, but it's getting the opportunity first. That's the key. Getting the opportunity, show what you've got, show what you can do. And there's many examples I could quote down through the years that these young players that went on to become great, great players were given opportunities for different reasons, injuries, relegation that allows them to play in the first team. Anton Ferdinand and Elliot Ward, great examples. Team got relegated. Alan Pardew was the manager. Was unsure about putting them in the team, but he put them in the team, and they did well and got promoted at Cardiff. And those opportunities are not quite there as they were, but certainly in the Premier League. But Declan got in, okay. Mark Noble got in and stayed in through all those years. Ben Johnson's in and out of the team a little bit, and he's part of the squad, an integral part of the squad. So I know Mark retired last year, but they were three, and Declan is one that, you know, we picked up at when he was 13, 14 from Chelsea. And he's gone on and done marvellous. When I spoke to him last week, funnily enough, I was lucky enough to get invited to David Gold's funeral by his two daughters, which I was quite humbled about. And a lot of the boys were there, and Declan was there. And I spoke to Declan and I said, your rise has been up marvellous since we signed you as a youngster from Chelsea, and you came in. And he was a great example that Chelsea didn't think he was good enough. Comes to West Ham, we signed him and played him in midfield, then played him at centre-back, and then he went back into midfield. And arguably, he could do both roles now. But, you know, he's turning out to be one of the best players in England. And our club take credit for that, West Ham, and for spotting that talent in the first place, nurturing him, bringing him through. And, you know, we know what might happen in the summer, but... certainly is a great success.
And there you go. And as I said, go and check out the rest of the interview. It's about an hour and a half. It's brilliant. It's a really good interview. Tony's fantastic. And also keep an eye out for his book as well. He's got his book out. And also he'll be doing some events with Ian and E13 to celebrate his time at the club. An evening with Tony Carr, and maybe a dinner as well with some of his academy graduates as well. So there's plenty of them to pick for, isn't there, to be honest. So keep an eye out for that. And the next story sort of follows through. He's both at Declan Rice, and that sort of followed through nicely. Obviously, Nobes did a comprehensive interview with the Evening Standard. We've covered a couple of the topics, but it was such a comprehensive interview that, you know, we didn't even touch on the Declan Rice discussion in terms of what he was quoted and saying. So obviously we know Nobes and Rice have a father-son, but a bloodly relationship, and they have since a very young age with Declan. And so he's, you know, he's always got his ear. Now, he was quoted, Nobes obviously is now sporting director at West Ham, and obviously we know there's not an open secret, but there is a high chance of Mr. Rice moving elsewhere in the summer. He was asked that question directly in the interview, and so the West Ham sporting director said this. See, and again, I'm not saying Mark Noble. The interview was as the West Ham sporting director. He said, it's just the world we live in. We're West Ham, and these players want to go and play Champions League football. And do you blame them? Deck is no different. Deck will always be hailed at West Ham as a fantastic player and such a top, top person. But I don't think anyone begrudges him wanting to go on and win things. We'll just hope he'll keep performing like he has been with us over the last month or so. Wherever Deck ends up, or however much someone pays for him, whether it's here or anywhere, he's worth every penny. He said openly he loves playing for West Ham, but he has got ambitions as a player and play in the Champions League and win trophies. I don't think any West Ham fan can actually have any agenda over that. And I know what he means, and it's true, but it's a little bit strange when, like, you know, not strange, but, you know, when the sporting director comes out and says that, and Moyes has been saying that in the press conference, you know, wherever he may choose to be. Obviously, we had the Jim White thing, and £120 million was the price tag. So the conversation is going out on multiple channels about him. It'd be interesting to see the next development and who's the next person to come out and say something about that. Now, speaking of Declan Rice, we were lucky enough to grab 20-25 minutes with Scott Minto to talk about the Chelsea game, obviously on Tuesday, on Saturday. He's got foot in both camps. And obviously, we then had a discussion about Enzo Fernandez and then Declan Rice, because, you know, it's sort of, were, you know, one falls into the other in terms of the amount of money Chelsea spent on Enzo Fernandez, Declan Rice with a price tag and things like that. And this is Scott's take on Declan Rice.
Well, I think Dec actually... See, I saw a lot of Enzo Fernandez. I work in the Portuguese league. So yes. I just didn't see him in the World Cup. I saw him for Benfica this season and he was bossing games and he's a really, really good player. But I love Dec.
Yeah.
And I think he's got even more to his game. Mm. I think he just keeps on getting better and better from when he first came in the side where he's meant to be a centre-half, and then he was pushing to midfield, but actually he's going to go back to centre-half. And then you realise, actually, he's just getting better and better as a centre midfield and can affect the game in that position. I think he's got even more to his game. You know, people say, does he score enough goals? Well, I don't think he's allowed to get forward as much. You know, if back in the day, a 4-4-2, and, you know, one would go, one would sit, one would go, one would sit. If they had that, then I think that would be fine. But I think where Deck is, first of all, he seems a really good lad. I don't know him, but he seems a really good lad. I think he'd be a great teammate. But I also can just see from the outside that when things aren't going well, or even setting standards in training, which someone like Nobes would have done, yeah, even though he wasn't playing regularly. And I think that's been a miss as well, where the standards in training on a daily basis, I think Deck would be the one now to be stepping up to doing that. Perhaps not still at the level that Nobes would have done. But so there's that. There's the character of the guy. There's the standards of the guy. And then there's the ability of the guy as well, where he can play as a holding midfielder. Yeah. And he's brilliant at that. But you almost feel he's slightly wasted in that.
Yeah,
you know, you love seeing him running with the ball. He's one of the best central midfielders, holding midfielders, running with the ball in the world. You know, it's almost like he seems to get quicker and the players who are chasing him, even though he's got the ball, can't catch him up.
Yeah.
There's been a bit of a question mark about his sort of long-range passing, and maybe he can not gamble a bit more, but just trust his own ability and trust his passing a bit more. But I think it's going to be really interesting, because I know West Ham fans won't like me, you know, what I'm about to say, but I do think they're resigned to it, that this is Deck's last season.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. It's an open secret. You know, it's an open secret.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So, and I don't think West Ham fans begrudge him for that either, because they know he's a Champions League player. If the Hammers could have got into the top four and kicked on this season, then he can say, look, we're in the Champions League and stay with us. Mm. But he's not just an international, he's a Champions League player as well. So then you're coming up, so then, which is why the narrative now is about how much, you know, price tags coming out.
Yeah.
Because I think he's got a year left with an option. So it's basically two years. So this is the time now. This is the summer. Because if you go till next season, 1 year left in your contract, you can halve the fee, really.
Yeah.
So now they're trying to build it up. And actually, if Dec outplays Enzo on Saturday, then the narrative would be even more. See, 105, 106 million for him. How can he not be at least that?
Yeah.
And actually, if you want to go down that route anyway, I believe Deck's worth more. Mm. Now, what he's done in the Premier League and for England is more than what Enzo Fernandez has done. Well, obviously won in the Premier League, but even in the Portuguese League, and even though he helped them to the World Cup, I think he only made his first cap in September. So Deck's been around a little bit longer. So I would say if you want to go down that route, then he's worth more than Enzo Fernandez. But how can you compare? You know, it's like you're buying a house, Russ.
Yeah, exactly.
That's what someone willing to pay.
Yeah.
So it depends on that individual. And Chelsea, we know, are spending a lot of money.
Yeah, you're totally right. I think you know, as you're right, it sort of puts this parameter up there now. So you sort of compare them to the market value. It's in terms, it's the same as a house, isn't it? It's like you see the house across the road and that's gone for £750,000. You're thinking, actually, our house is slightly better. Have we got a conservatory? Have they got a conservatory? Have they,
well, they're overpaying you at West Ham, £750,000 house. I love West, that.
How about, oh, well, yeah, okay, right, yeah. It's Hornchurch, isn't it? So, you know, it was, although I do keep the wife says it's Emerson Park, not Hornchurch, Russ.
Is that right? You could probably double 750, really. I know, really. But go on anyway.
It's Hornchurch. But you know what I mean? So it is true. And I think it's going to be really interesting. I think. And there we go. And as you said, if you want to listen to the full chat, really good chat with Scott. Talks about Chelsea, talks about West Ham in terms of the present day. Not so much, not really much about his time, but in terms of where we are currently in terms of the preview, that was at lunchtime today. And that's it, my friends. Thank you very much for your time. Tomorrow we'll be having our live, have you say, the club call. The West Ham club call, phone in on lunchtime on Friday. So make sure you have, you know, be there for that. We'll have the press conference. We'll have Jonty Coleman from Football London's take on the press conference. The late show with Irish Tommy and all the previews. We have match day morning on the Saturday morning if I can get my ass out of bed early enough. All that stuff coming up. So make sure you subscribe to the channel. Take care. Stay safe. Stay warm. Stay humble. Keep the faith, my friends. And we'll see you guys very, very soon.